Hello everyone. Welcome to Physiotherapy in Lesotho. www.physioinlesotho.ch. You are listening to a podcast from one of our physio workshop in Lesotho. Your speaker is Ndade Tuso W. Fassa, a qualified physiotherapist.
Now, in this first moment, let us talk about prevention of bed rest complications. This is a procedure we do in physio. Yesterday, on the ward, we did already a little bit of that. Now, I just explain it a little bit more. Patient on bed rest, whatever they have, if it is maybe an infection disease or they had a trauma or a burn or whatever, patient on bed rest, prolonged bed rest, that means not 2-3 days, a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks. These patients, they risk complications. On one hand, they heal, but on the other hand, they risk. And the most frequent complication is the bed sores, we all know. They risk as well to have thrombosis or embolia, some problems of the circulation, because they don't move. Deep venous thrombosis, DVT. It's not so frequently, but it happens. Or they risk some respiratory problem. Maybe they already had a cough and then they are lying, they are breathing superficially. The air is not going down to all the lung, not expanding the lung. So sputum remains there and it's a good place to infect. So they get pneumonia. It is possible. For prolonged bed rest, they risk as well to get stiff joints. Mainly the foot just dropping always down, so they risk to get a drop foot. The foot is just pointed downwards, or sometimes flexed knees. They risk as well that when they are on prolonged bed rest, that their blood pressure is going down because it's not activated. Then more a minor problem is many of them risk to become constipation, that they have difficulties with the bowels then because they are passive. And sometimes, it depends a little bit of the person, but sometimes they risk to become a bit depressed. They are lying in the bed, everybody is going out and coming in and so, but they are just lying there. So looking at the wall, thinking on their problems, thinking the problems they maybe have at home. So sometimes they are socially a little bit deprived. They have not enough contact, they have not enough input from outside. Patients who go out maybe to the corridor or outside of the hospital, they have a little walk, they can see many things, they can talk to the people, they have some social contact. A bed rest patient sometimes is losing that, so they get a bit of depressed. And when the patient is depressed, it doesn't help for healing. These are the main complications we have. The dangerous one is the bed sores. When they infect, it's always a big problem. And when bed sores start and they become maybe 2-3 centimeters wide and then they become a little bit deep, it's always a long problem. Okay? It takes time to heal them. So this is a problem. If there is thrombosis, it can be a huge problem because that thrombosis can become embolia. That means that blood clot is going up the vessel and can go into the heart or into the brain or in the lungs. So that's a problem. Pneumonia can become a very acute problem. Remember, we still can die on pneumonia. So pneumonia can become a big problem. The other problems are less severe, but still nasty. If somebody is 3 weeks on the bed and afterwards when you want to stand up with him, the foot is stiff. It gives you a headache to mobilize then that the patient can walk. Or constipation can be a problem, a nasty problem. They cannot go to toilet and it's difficult then to eat and so. But these are minor problems. But the other three, the first three, they are big problems and we can prevent them. we really can help and do a lot to prevent them. So if we say the aim of this procedure, prevention of bed rest complication, we should just have bed rest physio. The first aim is to prevent bed sources. Bed rest physio, the bed rest program, wants to prevent bed sources. We do that by moving the patient with passive, assisted, active exercises. And we position the patient. So the patient will be turned to the left, to the right, just moving as the clinical condition allows. If somebody has a broken pelvis, pelvis in many pieces, you cannot lie them on the side, and let's say in the first month, it's not possible. So at least you lift up the pelvis sometimes a little bit to ease the pressure on the buttocks. But if somebody has no broken bones, you can turn them to the left, you can turn them to the right. And ideally, we do that every 2 hours during the day, and every 4 hours during the night. So the nurse is involved in that too. So during the day, every 2 hours.
Changing of the position.
Changing position. Turning on the left, turning on the right. Let's say you have a paralytic patient, you're moving every 2 hours. Or that and that we were talking before. Lying on the bed, working in that room, I would take care every 2 hours, this and that is changing position. To the left, to the right. Yesterday when we came, he was lying on the left. So after 2 hours, I would go there and say, now you turn on the right. So we do passive, assisted and active movements, and we do positioning during the day every 2 hours and at night 4 hours. The second aim is we prevent thrombosis. That means we do a lot of active exercises of toes, feet and the leg. When you move the feet, you are activating the so-called muscle pump. The muscle, the lower leg, is working, flexing the toes, extending the toes, circling the foot, tip-tap up and down with the foot. These exercises, you do them intensively and long enough, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, they are activating the blood flow. So blood is moving. And we lift up the leg in the straight leg raise exercise. We lift it up that the venous blood is running out. These exercises, they help to activate the circulation and to reduce the chance to have thrombosis. And if you see your patient has varicosis, these bad veins, then you have to do it even more. So the second goal is preventing thrombosis by activating, by doing active exercises and straight leg raise. If somebody had already once a thrombosis or a pulmonary embolia, then we are especially careful. We elevate the legs, and I bandage them. Bandaged legs make that the blood flows quicker, is not clotting. So if somebody already had circulation problems, we are even more careful. So we elevate the legs and we bandage the leg. Every morning I do a good bandaging to them from the foot up to the hip. Remember, while doing compression bandaging, blood flows quicker. And when the blood flows quicker, it will less clot. When the blood is not flowing because the legs are passive, then the blood can clot. Now that bandaging is not so common. In maybe 20, 30 years ago, it was absolutely common. Every woman who gave birth got a bandage on the legs. They said, we have to prevent thrombosis. Now in these days it's not so common. The other day when I was bandaging a patient who was very swollen, as that patient yesterday, the midwife called me and said, what are you doing here? Then I said, oh, I'm doing compression bandaging to ease off this lymphatic edema. And she wanted to know in detail. And she said, are you sure that you are not strangling the circulation? Of course. We are not strangling, we are applying some force, not too little, not too much. So, in a compression as we did yesterday, you never squeeze the artery. It won't be strong enough. To squeeze an artery, you have to compress very much. But we do some compression. So people today are not used anymore to this compression bandaging. It's something we used much before, and today we use it for this prevention of thrombosis and for reducing swelling. It works perfectly, and we just need two bandages. You have seen yesterday, it was great, the result. And today we will do it again, to this intate. So if you have a case where already thrombosis, we do special precautions, we elevate the leg, and we do compression bandaging from the morning until the evening, and things will become good. Now, the prevention of respiratory complication is the third aim. In bed rest physio, we have to prevent respiratory problems. That means we do respiratory exercise. Deep breathing exercise, percussion, vibration, we ask them to cough. We just deepen the ventilation, we clear the airway. This is the physio for the chest. Being active, breathing deeper, that helps to the circulation as well, and it helps to the intestine. But if somebody is complaining of being constipated, the nurse will give the medicine. We will say, eat more vegetables and drink enough. Avoid to eat too much stage food, too much carbohydrates. Avoid to eat too many bananas, because bananas, they somehow, they make the feces more solid. When we have diarrhea, it's good to eat a banana, but if we are constipated, we shouldn't eat banana. Just by the way, do you know that banana have an antidepressive effect? It helps for the soul. They are somehow antidepressive, and people with cramps in the leg, when they eat regular banana, cramps get better.
Cramps?
Yes, muscle cramps. If there is not enough magnesium, they shall eat lenses and banana. Now, if that person has already constipation, or maybe before the bed rest, she was already a patient who suffered of constipation, what can you do? Now, in physio, you know what we're doing? We're making, it's called the hot roll. I take a big bath towel, I fold it, and I roll it together. So it's like a roll, you understand? Then I pour boiling water in the middle of that roll. So the inside of the towel is wet and warm. And then I slowly massage that belly with that warm towel. And slowly I roll it off so that always the warm part of that towel is massaging the belly. I do a belly massage with the hot roll. It's a hot, wet towel. But slowly, slowly, gently we will do that. And I massage. Or I can take just a warm, humid towel. I put a hot water bottle in it. And I put that on the belly. We cover it with blanket. So we just warm this belly up. And then you massage it with abdominal massage. And you will see how that constipation will improve. Sometimes, even quickly, after half an hour, that patient will call the nurse, "Oh, Mimi, urgently, I have to have the bedpan." Sometimes the day later. But you will be surprised how it can work. In severe cases, I use that bag with the dried herbs I told you. You remember? I take a feather case from a pillow. I put some dry herb, so grass, in it. I make it a little bit humid and I put a hot water bottle in it. And in this bag, I put it on the belly and cover it with blanket. It will relax the intestine very much. These are natural recipes from old ancient European traditional medicine, and they work perfectly. To avoid low blood pressure and problems of orthostatic nature, orthostatic means when the patient stands up, blood pressure should be organized. When you're lying, you don't need a lot of blood pressure, but when you sit up or stand up, blood pressure has to rise a bit. If a patient lies for 2-3 months or 2-3 weeks in the bed, this reaction is weak. So when they sit up, they get dizzy. So to prevent this, we do exercise. Exercising regularly helps to prevent this problem. And now for the last thing, to prevent social deprivation. We really take time. We talk to this patient when we go to the bed. We organize that somebody, another one, is maybe going to talk to them. We bring them the news. Maybe I bring them a newspaper, or maybe there is a radio and they can listen to some radio. Just keep contact, or maybe organize contact. Sometimes there is a patient who is mobile. I said, "Why don't you go and sit to that and that a little bit to his bed and you chat with him? He's so lonely in his bed in that angle over there." So you organize a little bit contact. So whenever you pass by that bed, we greet and say, "Hello, what are you doing? How's it?" And so keep contact with this person. If you don't see arriving relatives, ask, "Why are they not coming?" So organize the people, organize contact for this chap, that they are not getting socially deprived. Sometimes it's possible to put the bed on a better position if the bed is on the last end or maybe in a cubicle. And nobody goes there. Sometimes we put the bed more among the other beds so they can see more people and they can have more activity. So prevent social deprivation by keeping relationship, keeping contact, organizing contacts. It's so important that people don't feel lost. So practically what we do is we go to the patient and I prepare the situation. I take all the blankets off, I put the blankets on a chair. If the patient needs to be dressed, he shall be dressed. And we prepare. Second, I inform the patient. I tell the patient, "Now we're coming to do the exercise and for what we're doing this exercise." Then after a week, that patient will know you nicely, so you don't have to explain every time what you have to do. But we inform the patient. We get in touch with him, we ask, "How are you today?" and so on. And then we are doing active exercises wherever you can. Let's say there is a broken leg on the right and the leg is on traction. So on this leg, he cannot do flexion extension of the leg, but the toes he can move. So I said, bend and extend your toes, do a lot. Maybe in the ankle he can do little movement. So there, let's do the movement. Maybe the thigh he can tie up, not making a movement, but making the muscle a bit strong, a bit tight. Can I? Okay. But then the left leg, I will move a hollow. And the arms, I move a lot. The neck, I move a lot. I let them bend the neck, doing some abdominal exercises. I give them even bottles full of little stones so they can do push-ups with the arm to strengthen the arm muscle, because this patient, when he gets off bed, will walk on crutches. So he needs good arm muscle. So I give him heavy objects to do exercises for the arms. I give him a straw to do deep breathing exercises. And when he breathes out through the straw, he will breathe in even more deeper. I will do percussion vibration to him, to the chest, just to deepen ventilation, to clear the airways. I do things like that. Always you can move in one way or another. When the patient is weak, we will do assisted movement. If he's very weak, I do passive movement, but I move. Remember, even when I do straight leg raise exercise, circulation gets better. So we apply the three rules from yesterday. Let the patient do what they can do. So all the movements they can do, use them. Let the patient do what they can do. Second rule, help the patient where they need help. Maybe he cannot really lift up the leg completely, so you assist a little bit. You do just a little so that the movement can take place. You do not everything. And third, do what the patient cannot do. If the patient is paralyzed, he cannot move the leg, I will move the leg. Because the joints have to be flexible, the circulation has to go, I will do it. This is a very good set of rules, and I apply it to everything. Therefore, I said yesterday to this and that, he's able to wear buddhichnet. To put his trousers on. So please, put your trousers on. He's able to do it, he shall do it. He was not able to hold himself while sitting, so we do that, we were holding him. We helped him to sit. Normally, a bed rest program takes maybe 15 minutes. In 15 minutes, we have done it. And we go from bed to bed, where there is a bed rest patient, we will do that. And it's a preventive physiotherapy, you can see. In palliative physio, we do it as well. Because even if the person is going to die, and is maybe in his last few days or last weeks, we give them more comfort, so the suffering is easier to bear. By moving them, they feel more fresh in the legs, and the legs feel less heavy when you move them. When you help them to breathe a bit deeper, they cope a bit better, they can relax. They have more peace. So we help to have more life quality, even if it is on the last days. This is the procedure for bed rest physio, standard program. I will talk today or tomorrow with the superintendent that we can agree that this is a standard program. Whenever there is a bed rest patient, you know, you can give him this procedure.